Please call the next case.
Name Ray, Rob, Gavin Lawson, Thomas Burke, Collins, Arnold W. Roth, and Lauren B. Roth. Melissa K. B. Secker, Council for Appley, Elizabeth F. Rojas, Chapter 13, Trustee.
Good morning, Your Honors. If it pleases the court.
Counsel's also come to the phone. Please introduce yourself and go ahead. And we're here. Please introduce.
Good morning. I'm Melissa Bessiker, appearing for appellee.
Thank you very much.
Janet Lawson, if it pleases the court, on behalf of the appellant.
And how much time do you wish to reserve for rebuttal?
5 minutes.
Please proceed.
All right, thank you. So this is a due process case. Klein's Chapter 13 case was dismissed on grounds that proved later to be untrue, that they were not over the debt limit. Debtor number two had signed the amended plan. There were no objections filed to the plan. And that's important that there were no objections filed, because not only were they not filed by the trustee, there were none filed by any creditors.
Were there ever any filed by creditors?
No. So the idea that the debtor's counsel made an error in noticing the hearing is really a non-fact, because no one had filed an objection. If someone had filed an objection, then that would indicate that they had read the plan and noted the incorrect date, at which point it could have been fixed. But since no one filed an objection, no one was harmed, because no creditor intended to appear. And in fact, no creditor had appeared at any of the previous confirmation hearings.
Well, you still would have to renotice it.
Correct. It would have to have been renoticed.
Yeah, the harm was that you weren't given that chance.
Correct. And that's what we mark as the major error. The major error being we didn't have time to go back and sort the math and show that the IRS debt was counted twice, and to show that the stripped off second was not a personal liability, therefore not an unsecured debt in the case. And had prior counsel had notice of these issues, I certainly could have addressed them. But when you show up to a hearing and these things are sprung on you, that's unfair.
Did your client request additional time?
Yes, he did. So what Mr. Berneman said was, I would like to brief that. And the judge made some comment about, you lose on that issue. That was the gist of what she said.
Then there wasn't really any formal request for a specific time, was
there? No, there was no request for a specific time, no. But he did ask for time to brief the issue.
Well, for regular counsel to brief the issue.
for regular counsel, yeah. And, I mean, I will concede it does point out the failures of using appearance counsel.
The risk, yes.
Yeah, there is an issue there in terms of somebody not knowing the case. But you could use appearance counsel if they were properly briefed and if they knew what the issues were.
So if they had raised the issue before the hearing, either appearance counsel could have been briefed or regular counsel could have appeared.
Correct. And that's where it fell apart.
There's no evidence in the record that I could find that this issue of the debt limit was ever raised before.
That's correct.
Okay.
It was never raised before. This was like first time, brand new, here we are. And as for the issue of the delay in the number of continuances, counsel wasn't just sitting on his hands. You know, he dealt with the IRS debt. He stripped off the second.
But there was some missteps.
There were some missteps. I will say, yes, I have to concede that.
Yeah.
they were missed.
And it was 14 months long at that point in time without a confirmation.
That is correct. But he was making the payments. And the trustee had a substantial amount of money on hand that could have gone to creditors had the case been confirmed. And with respect to the issue that the proof of claim of the first mortgage was not dealt with, they were off in their math by $1,000. And the plan clearly says your claim trumps what's in the plan. So the first had no problem. There would have been no problem with confirming the plan. The first would have been paid that extra $1,000 because their claim trumped the plan. So even though the plan wasn't perfect, it was certainly confirmable. And the trustee's argument is, oh, well, delay to creditors, delay to creditors. I think the dismissal was a significant harm to creditors because there was a big pool of money to be distributed.
Well, and there was an objection originally about feasibility, which really went to the IRS, which resolved. Right. But it seems like given the 14 months, the feasibility concerns were fairly soundly addressed by the payment of the $2,500 per month.
Yeah, he was making the payments. So
that raises an interesting point since we're coming up on a year since it was dismissed. If we were to accept your arguments and either reverse remand, what happens to that gap in the plan between last August when it was dismissed and essentially, you know, this August?
Well, I would argue that the case get set back.
They'd be told, or?
Yeah, they would be told.
Is there any support for that? I mean, we're kind of a little off here, but I mean, it makes a real, you know, 12 months of $2,500 payments is awfully hard to come up.
Yeah. Well, I think in fairness to the debtor, it should be told, and that amount of time should not count towards his 60 months that he can be in Chapter 13.
We would leave that to the trial judge.
Yeah.
Is that the, I mean, I don't.
It's an interesting issue, but it is beyond the scope of this, so we don't need to go any further.
But, you know, I would argue that it be told as well as the amount of time towards his 60 months to pay for the plan.
Counsel, you characterize your argument as a due process argument, and due process is, you know, just an adequate opportunity or notice that something to fix something.
Right.
It's yet quite a while to fix all the problems in this case. What you're really saying here is that the judge just didn't have support in the record for the grounds that the judge stated for dismissing the case. It really isn't due process. You just think the judge got it wrong.
Well, the judge did get it wrong. That is true.
Well, say it.
Yeah. He said it more eloquently than I could have. But not only did she get it wrong, she got it wrong because
her
there
facts
was a
were
prior
wrong.
Notice. And it, had there been notice, we wouldn't be here today.
Yeah.
So, although...
But at some point, you went back to court. You said, well, we are eligible. They had the numbers wrong. The trustee... honestly admitted that the numbers are wrong, and the judge still dismissed the case.
Correct.
That isn't due process. That's just getting it wrong.
That is true. When you're preparing these briefs, it's pretty hard sometimes to write, I'm sorry, Your Honor, but da-da-da-da-da.
We share that problem.
Yeah. I do have to appear back in front of that judge at some point. So, you know, how you phrase things can come back. And
you have almost 7 minutes, 6 minutes and 43 seconds. Why don't you take that rebuttaling?
Okay, thank you.
Counsel, did the judge get it wrong?
Good morning. May it please the court, Melissa Besker for the Chapter 13 trustee, Elizabeth Rojas. No, the judge...
Would you pick one of the microphones and speak into it?
No, the judge did not get it wrong. The court has discretion to dismiss a case.
What did she dismiss the case for?
Pardon me?
What did she dismiss the case for? What was the basis?
For an unjustifiable delay to creditors.
All right, and so there was unjustifiable delay, but also has to be prejudicial. So
yes.
Why was it unjustifiable?
Well, it was unjustifiable because the case was filed was 14 months prior.
14 months had eliminated a substantial lien and recharacterized the IRS debt to a limited amount of $2,500 for secured. Unsecured, I didn't see priority. Seems like things were happening. Nothing ever happens as expeditiously as anybody wants, but there were major things happening in that case. Why was it unreasonable?
Well, it was unreasonable because the length of time.
Length of time alone can't make it unreasonable, though. It has to be contextual. And in this context where there are actions going fairly lockstep, why was that unreasonable?
Well, but creditors had not received any payments. While it's true that the debtors were making their payments, those payments, that those monies, funds could not be dispersed.
What would it have taken to disperse the money, given that you put an erroneous, I don't know if you personally, but somebody put an erroneous theory in front of the judge, which I don't think you can gainsay that was at the trial level or at the initial hearing level, that argument that they didn't qualify had to have carried tremendous weight with her. She said it did. So once you realized, or your client realized, that was wrong, what was left to get this case confirmed and to get that money that was sitting there, which was what, like $35,000 or something like that, to creditors?
The plan would have had to have been noticed again.
Okay. And what? So we're talking another 30 days to get it noticed, rough numbers to get it noticed. Anything else? Because you didn't even object to, your client didn't even object to the plan that was pending. I mean, there was clearly a notice problem. They've acknowledged that. No question we'd have to have some additional notice. And the judge could have said, hey, if you don't make your payment in the interim, I'm sua sponte dismissing it, and I'd be fine with that given the passage of time. But I'm really trying to struggle. You're saying there's prejudice because they didn't get anything, so what would it take? Was it not on the horizon, we're ready to grab the gold ring and disperse the money?
I think that the court was really concerned with the delays, with the nature of the delays, as well as the length of time, and I think it came to a breaking point at that time where it would just be another delay, and there's no guarantee.
But what was the nature of the delay? You keep saying delay for 14 months, but again, the 14 months isn't alone the indicator. There's no cutoff that 12 months is therefore per se undue delay. What was the undue part of it? And it wasn't really explained in the transcript, short as it was, largely because, as Judge Taylor indicated, the focus was on the debt limit.
Well, the debtor needed to file a motion to avoid the lien, which I think was not done right away originally, and also the objection to the claim took quite a while to accomplish,
fairness, that objection was subsumed within the motion to avoid lien, and it appears from a reading of the record that there was a realization that the IRS's lien was larger than just the real property, so it had to be an objection. And that's what I mean. It could have been done quicker, but it was being done. And it's akin to Judge Taylor's point as the need for notice. It's not like when the debtor filed the second plan, the amended plan, that they did not notice it. They realized it had to be noticed. It was noticed. They just got it wrong. So that seems to be the flavor of this case, is some things were done wrong, but there's nothing that suggests that anything was done maliciously wrong, but they were actually being done, which is more than a lot of cases. So why was it undue, and where is the harm? That's the trouble I'm having.
Well, the bankruptcy court, in my experience, does not generally see that length of a delay, and I really think it fell on the length of time.
Where's that in the record?
Pardon me?
Where's that in the record?
I don't believe, no, the court did not specifically state that, no. But There were many hearings, and matters were discussed.
And part of the problem is we don't have the transcripts of any of the prior hearings. So we, you know, you really can't argue, I think, here today that warning was given or that, you know, that's not a tool you have in your toolbox.
Right. Well, except that the local bankruptcy rules do specifically say that the plan does need to be noticed. And the error in the noticing, it really appears that this was just a recycled notice because that was the original hearing date. And
it was sloppy.
It seems that, you know, the debtor after so long would want to get the case confirmed and would...
I'm sure the debtor did.
Yes.
The debtor doesn't necessarily appear that it was sloppy. Those debtor's lawyers may have been. So you're going to penalize the debtor for making 14 months of fairly substantial payments because you used a form and didn't catch the 2017 was on there instead of 2018 and the right date.
Well, counsel represents debtor. The counsel is acting on behalf of the debtor.
Mm-hmm.
Counsel, as you can see, the panel is sort of struggling. You know, we're bankruptcy judges.
Yes.
None of us would have dismissed this case. But we understand that judges are different, and they have different standards, and some judges are much more hard-nosed than others. And so, and we give deference, and the hard-nosed judges prevail in this court more often than not because we understand they run their court and we're not here to second guess that kind of judgment or to substitute our judgments for theirs. The problem here is that when we push away some of the problems here, frequently the complaints that are being made here are just wrong. The eligibility issue which came up was just wrong. The other things that the debtor needed to do, the debtor accomplished. And so it's kind of hard to understand for us why this judge dismissed this case on this record.
Yeah. Well, as far as the...
And what your answer is, it just took too long. But that seems like there should be more than that.
And as far as the eligibility issue and the issues that were brought up, which were an error... Again, debtor's counsel did not dispute those, and in fact, it didn't address the.
If he had notice of that being a problem, he would have disputed it because he would have been able to see what the problem was.
Well, it's a very simple problem, and debtor's counsel should be familiar with what the schedules are and what the.
I think the eligibility issue is substantive, and frankly. The fact that this is where I don't think I disagree, but I do see a due process point, which is you're coming in with a significant argument. You haven't objected to the plan. You haven't raised it. Your client, I keep saying you, and I'm not, but your client hasn't raised it previously. It has sort of a gotcha quality to it, and I'm not sure it would be right it was factually wrong, and I'm not sure it'd be right as a matter of law to say what you do after the case is ongoing. We usually look at the Ninth Circuit is telling us to look at the time of the filing. So that was a complicated legal issue, and the attorney who was there, again, acknowledged they had appearance counsel. Would they have had appearance counsel if they knew there was a serious attack on eligibility? I doubt it. Would they have addressed it if they knew there was going to be a serious attack on eligibility? I doubt it. That really changed the whole complexion of that hearing in a fundamental way. So I guess I'm emoting now more than really asking you a question, which I guess I get to do that. But why isn't that a huge problem here? And she had the opportunity on reconsideration to tell us why the simple fact of delay was enough. We don't have those findings.
Do you mean the court?
Right.
I see. Yes. Well, I think also as far as the eligibility issue, Mr. Berneman is appearance counsel, but he is generally familiar with the cases that he appears on, and I believe that the court would put a lot of faith in what Mr. Berneman said.
But you're missing the point, too, which is your client got it wrong.
Oh, no, I really agree.
Yeah, so I mean, it's somewhat disarming to say, well, it was their fault for not catching our mistake, which was not noticed previously. That
sprung on him at a hearing.
Yeah.
I understand, but except that instead of saying, I had never heard that issue before, debtors, we request to brief this or to review the documents. Instead, Mr. Berneman said, my only argument is that it would have been secured. He went off and actually made
an argument. So your argument now is that his mistake was he believed you and entrusted you when you gave him that number.
Well, I think that he should have said that he didn't believe that was true or had reviewed the schedules and seen that it wasn't
true.
Could
you help me? Because until this case, I never heard of appearance counsel. Is that a practice in your district?
Yes, it is.
It's a California thing.
It's fairly common, and there are some counsel that do appear regularly, and some are better than others. And some actually do review the files and try to be familiar with the issues in the case.
Do you honestly think, though, that an appearance counsel, even the best, would go back and reread the schedules where the issue is this plan that's in front of them after all the water that's gone under the bridge and would be anticipating an eligibility argument that you've emphasized the case was been pending for 14 months? Eligibility is usually raised way in the rearview mirror. And again, I'm not sure it's correctly raised when you change the character of debt during the course of the case as a matter of law.
Well, it was raised because the motion to avoid the lien and the objection presented that issue.
But it wasn't
an issue that we
How long did the trustee know they were going to be doing this? I mean, it's 14 months. At some point, way in the rearview mirror, those motions were filed. You've told me we had 8 hearings. Why didn't you say earlier, hey, if you win on those, you're not going to be eligible? I mean, there's a gotcha quality to this that I have a real problem with.
Right. I mean, I don't like the gotcha.
I don't mean that pejoratively,
It wasn't something we were saving. It was just something that when we reviewed the file again for the 9th or 10th time before the hearing, that issue it came up because we were looking at the new plan with the now resolved objection and lien avoidance. It was an issue that we hadn't had the foresight at the beginning of the case to look at to say, well, if you are going to do this, then this might be a problem.
And what's the appropriate response at that point? Isn't the appropriate response, we better go look at this, just continue the hearing? Or is the appropriate response case dismissed?
Well, again, I think the court was relying on, unfortunately, the trustee, what the trustee said was incorrect, and also relying on debtor's apparent agreement with that.
So. I think the debtor asked to brief the issue. I don't think the debtor agreed. I think the debtor also relied on the trustee, which is a good thing. Usually you can rely on the trustee not to make an argument that's absolutely... I mean, there were two arguments. There was the didn't sign the document argument, wrong, and the two arguments that were just flat out dead bang wrong, and that's unusual. It's very unusual for a trustee to do that, in my experience at least. It happens to all of us, but it's unusual.
No further questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Counsel, you have some time for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. To please the court, I don't specifically have anything really new to say, but I certainly agree, you know, here we are at confirmation and there's two wrongs. And Mr. Berneman did ask for time to brief an issue, but I think that issue he identified to brief was incorrect because he didn't understand the nature, the full nature of the argument, you're over the debt limit. And I think he was thinking that the issue would have been resolved at the beginning of the case in the sense that the second would have been stripped off. So does it count for the debt limit? And obviously it does. But I think that's what he grasped. When I look at what he said and the response to the judge, which was essentially, no, you lose on that issue. And so she didn't give him time, you know, to set it over one more time for that to be briefed. I don't think he grasped that it was the IRS debt had been counted twice. I think he was thinking of, you file a case and you want to strip off a lien. Well, that lien counts as of the day you filed the case. So I think there was some confusion on his part when he asked for time to brief.
But isn't the important point that he didn't acquiesce?
That is the important point. He did not acquiesce. He did not say, okay, you win. Here we are. So, and I'm quite familiar with Mr. Berneman, and he is an appearance counsel, and generally speaking, he does a great job. He asks, you know, for documents when we ask him to appear on one of our cases. And I'm also familiar with the employees of the trustee's office, which include Ms. Besseker, who I admire and I would believe, you know, standing at the council table.
And I'm sure any attorney would, or any judge would as well.
Exactly.
And this was on a motion calendar, right? I mean, this seems like it came on
fairly
deep into a motion calendar. And
well, they do it kind of oddly. They, in Santa Barbara, the motions, everything gets set at 10. The motions get heard first, followed by confirmation. But if your case has a motion and it's on for confirmation, the judge will do the two of them together. So you might look at the calendar and go, geez, I'm 69 or 70 or something like that. But if you have a motion on and you're number four, boom, you go right to the top.
This was only for just confirmation, though, wasn't it?
I think so, yes. It was just confirmation.
I mean, that's part of the point, too, is that there was no motion.
Yeah, there were no motions.
But it was an uncontested confirmation, is that
correct?
Correct.
It was uncontested. No one objected. Not even a creditor.
So Judge Taylor's right, Judge Kurtz is wrong. It does have due process concerns.
Well,
I'm used to that, by the way. So.
Yeah. Well, it's a flavor, not a...
Yeah. It's one of my favorite flavors, so when it comes to arguing, I always tend to go there.
Yeah.
Moline case is one of my favorites. I have no additional comments if you have.
Thank you very much. The matter is deemed submitted.